Yev.
And I'm James.
We're here on another episode of Stocks and Storage. Today, talking about consensus estimates. So I was dipping my toe into the stock market, or at least, you know, kind of paying attention to things. I noticed a stock just completely fell off the face of the earth, and I was trying to read up on what happened. And what they were talking about was consensus opinion. And I was immediately out of my depth, hence I'm here with you. Tell me what on earth consensus opinion is.
Well, I think first you have to start out with, you know, who's providing consensus. And what consensus is, it's the average of the forecasts of analysts that cover a company. So, you know, when they said that a company missed consensus, that means that they reported financial results that were below what was forecast by analysts.
Got it. And so us as a public company, we also have analysts. So assumption being that we also have a consensus opinion.
Yes, that's right. So there are 6 sell-side analysts, they're called, that cover our company. So I used to be one for 12 years.
Convenient so, yeah. That you're here to explain it to me.
That's right, and I survived. But I like to think of them as kind of like the nerdy rock stars of Wall Street. This is, you know, you see analysts on CNBC sometimes. They're responsible for the official opinion of an investment bank on a company. And so, you know, they change their opinion on a stock. They usually rate a stock buy, sell, or hold. Hold being kind of on the fence. But when they change those ratings, a lot of times the stocks move.
So who are analysts, and why does anyone care what they think of when they're making this consensus opinion?
Why do people care what analysts think? Well, they're subject matter experts. I mean, they spend all day long working on, you know, an industry and focusing on a small set of companies. And so, you know, they may know more about a company and its prospects than anyone. Let's take Apple, for example. There's always a couple analysts that seem to kind of get the skinny on the next iPhone. You know, by the time they launch it, we already know what the features are gonna be.
It's like they're sitting in the conference room.
Well, more likely, you know, hanging out in Asia and talking to suppliers and manufacturers who are in the supply chain for Apple. But the point is, a lot of times this information gets out there from these analysts, these highly influential analysts, and by the time the product's launched, we all know what it is, and, you know, they can both, you know, dampen the enthusiasm for it if it's not exciting, or they can also, you know, fan the flames of enthusiasm if it's exciting. So, you know, I think that there are many examples like that, but Apple's kind of one where I think a lot of people probably hear those analyst reports and see that sort of happening in real time.
Makes sense then that they would be the ones creating the consensus estimates and opinions.
Part of what they do is they financially forecast all the companies that they cover. You know, they spend a lot of time with management teams and doing a lot of research, you know, on companies to try to come up with financial estimates that are good. Usually companies also provide guidance, is what it's called. They help analysts understand, you know, at least near term, what their results might look like, because the company has more information than anyone else on their business. But that's why it's so important when people see that a company has not delivered what analysts expected. I think one way to sum it up is that investors don't like surprises, at least especially bad ones. It's okay to surprise in a good way.
Fair enough. Pleasant surprises, pleasantly
yeah.
Surprised.
Yeah, that's right.
Well, thanks, James. I think I get it. And we'll hit the next topic on stocks and storage.